So let us quickly turn our Bibles to the book of 2 Chronicles chapter 17 and let us read from verse 3 onwards. 2 Chronicles chapter 17 and verse 3 onwards. Now the Lord was with Jehoshaphat because he walked in the former ways of his father David. He did not seek the Baals, but sought the Lord of his fathers and walked in the commandments and not according to the acts of Israel. Therefore the Lord established the kingdom in his hand, and all Judah gave presents to Jehoshaphat. He had riches and honor in abundance, and his heart took delight in the ways of the Lord. Moreover, he removed the high places and the wooden images from Judah. Hallelujah. Now verse 12, it says, so Jehoshaphat became increasing powerfully, and he built fortresses and storage cities in Judah. He had much property in the cities of Judah, and the men of war, mighty men of valor, were in Jerusalem. Hallelujah. Here we see the narrative speaking of King Jehoshaphat. Hallelujah. Now King Jehoshaphat was a man who was not really a king, he's a man who feared God. Hallelujah. Amen. Who walked in the statutes of God, who listened to the commandments of God. Hallelujah. And that's where we see clearly that God was there with Jehoshaphat at a very young age. From a very young age, he knew God. Hallelujah. Amen. And he walked in the ways and in the commandments of God. So what God did, God blessed him. And the Bible says that he became increasingly powerful and built fortresses and storage cities. He had much property in the cities of Judah, and the men of mighty men of valor were in Jerusalem with him. That was about King Jehoshaphat. Hallelujah. Now this King Jehoshaphat is a very mighty man of God. Why he was a mighty king and a mighty man of God? Because only one quality which we always see, that he walked with God. Hallelujah. Though he was king, he walked with God. Hallelujah. His father also, Asa, we studied before also, that in the early days of his reign that he walked with God, God blessed him and he prospered. But when he was diseased in his feet, he did not seek God, but he seeked the physicians. We know that. That is the father of King Jehoshaphat, Asa. We see clearly. But here we see, it's the same Jehoshaphat. We see also in the 20th chapter that when there are three kings, like Gentile kings, that Ammon, we see Moab and Mount Seir, when they come against King Jehoshaphat, they come against like a mighty wind to attack him. That's where we see that Jehoshaphat, King Jehoshaphat, goes into the presence of God and he seeks mercies for God. And God said, do not worry, be still and know that I am God, for the salvation belongs to Lord, for the Lord will fight for you. Hallelujah. That was the communion, that was the intimacy that King Jehoshaphat had with God. Hallelujah. And God gave him simple instructions, as we all know. He says, well, you just blow the trumpet, blow the horn and worship me, and I will cause confusion in the camp of the enemy. That's what happened. When you start praising and worshiping and glorifying God, there is confusion in the camp of the enemy. Hallelujah. The camp that will come to destroy you one way, he will flee in seven ways. The Bible clearly says, and here we see that what happened, that King Jehoshaphat was blessed. Amen. You see, that's what happened, my brother and sister, today. The Lord is telling that when you walk according to the commandments of God, I mean, obedient to what God says, he says what he says, that everything that whatever God has spoken in your life, or whatever God has prophesied through many prophets or to the child of God, those will surely come to pass. So let us look into Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 19, if you see that. He says, I call heaven and earth, Deuteronomy chapter 30 and verse 19, he says, I call heaven and earth as a witness today against you, that I have set before you life and death, blessing and cursing. Therefore choose life, that you and your descendants may live, that you may love the Lord your God, that you may obey his voice, and that you may cling to him, for he is your life and the length of your days, and that you may dwell in the land for which the Lord swore to your fathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and to Jacob, to give them. Hallelujah. So today the Lord is saying, what he's saying, that I have prolonged your days. Clearly, I call heaven and earth as a witness today. He says, I have put before you life and death, and I have put before you a blessing and a curse. Hallelujah. So the blessing will fall on your life is when you obey, or when you hearken to the voice of God. So there is also something which we need to do, that we need to obey. We need to obey his commandments and to walk with him to see all these blessings happening. Why? Because when he's given us a choice once again, he says life and death belongs to you. You see clearly, well, any time in life, one thing you need to understand, that God always gives a choice to people to choose. Hallelujah. He will never, never, never interfere with your will. because your will belongs to you. He will never interfere with your will. He will always give you a choice to choose. Hallelujah. He says, today I give you a choice to choose of life or death, to serve for a curse and a blessing. It's the person who makes the choice. It is not God who makes the choice. You need to understand clearly. That's what happened even to Abraham. When Abraham was with his niece, with his nephew Lot, clearly when there was a battle between the herdsmen of Lot and Abraham. And Abraham came and said to Lot, we are like brethren. We are brethren, we should not fight. So let us divide the land, whatever you want to choose. The choice was given. The choice was given. But what was the choice of Lot? The choice of Lot was he entered into the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. Though what he saw everything beautiful. He saw everything fertile. He thought everything fruitful. From afar he saw. And he says, okay, this is the place, this is the place, and this is the one in which I will go, and I will dwell with my descendants, and we will live. But was the choice of Lot correct? No, the choice of Lot was not correct, because he did not know exactly who lived or who dwelt in the city of Sodom and Gomorrah till he went there. Then he understood that they were Sodomites, they were homosexual people over there. And we know that the anger of the Lord came, and what happened? Destroyed the city of Sodom and Gomorrah and burnt up the entire city. Fire came down, brimstone came down. At the same time, God, because the Bible says the Lot was a righteous man, that God had to deliver him from the city of Sodom and Gomorrah. Hallelujah. But here we see what was the choice which he made. His choice, if you look like that, because all that glitter is not gold. You must clearly understand something. Why? Because that's what today the Lord is telling, that you need to choose. He said, choose life or you choose death. You choose a blessing or you choose curse. So for you to be blessed, there are certain principles which God puts in our lives. What is the principle is that we need to obey his word, that we must obey his word and may walk with him. Hallelujah. That's what we see in the life of King Josaphat. King Josaphat was blessed. He was blessed everything. Spiritually he was blessed. Physically he was blessed. Financially he was blessed. On only one condition he was blessed, because he feared God. He walked in the commands of God and he walked with God, even though the enemy tried to destroy and kill him. But still he said that he walked in the ways of his father David. Hallelujah. We clearly see that, and that's what is the main principle of our blessing clearly. So if we look into the book of Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 5, see what does it says in the book of Jeremiah chapter 17 and verse 5. The Bible says, thus says the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and make flesh his strength, whose heart depart from the Lord. For he shall be like a shrub in the desert, and shall not see when good come, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land where there is not inhabited. Hallelujah. He says, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes his flesh his strength. What happens? Whose heart departs from God. But if you see in verse 7, he says, blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and who hopes in the Lord, for he shall be like a tree that is planted by the waters, which spreads out its roots by the river and will not fear when heat comes. Its leaves will be green and it will not be, and he will not be anxious in the year of drought, nor will cease from yielding fruit. So here clearly, again the Lord is speaking in the book of Jeremiah. There are other things. He says, cursed is the person who trusts in flesh, for his heart departs in the Lord. That means there are two trusts. One is trusting in man and one is trusting in the living God. Hallelujah. That's why the Bible says, trust in the Lord at all times and lean not on your understanding. Do not trust in man. Why? Because when you trust in man, what happens? He says that his heart departs from the living God. But blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord and whose hope is in the Lord. Hallelujah. So our hope must always be in God. Amen. Our hope must always be in God. Though we may be in a hopeless situation, though we may be in a dry situation, though we may be in a situation that where we come to the crossroad and we think that is the end of the story, but the Bible says that our hope must still be in the Lord. Why? Because the word of God says in Proverbs chapter 23 verse 18 that your hope shall not be cut off. Hallelujah. The word of God says clearly, for hope does not disappoint us, for God's love has been poured through the Holy Spirit clearly. And here we see clearly what the Bible says, that cursed is the person who trusts in Amen. Hallelujah. So what God is telling for you to inherit the blessing again over here, he says what he says clearly, that you must obey the word of God. Hallelujah. That you must obey the word of God and you must trust in the Lord. Hallelujah. But the problem with many people, they lose their trust in God. When there are certain things that does not happen the way they expect it to happen, they lose their trust in God and they now start trusting man. You see clearly, they start trusting man. They start looking for help from where? From him. You see, but whereas David, look, he says, I look upon to the hill, from where does my help come? In Psalm 121, he says, I look upon to the hill, from where does my help come? My help come from the Lord who made the heaven and the earth. That was the trust that David had, because David believed in his heart that the God who called him will never leave him, will not forsake him. My brother and sister in Christ, and that's what we must be very careful to inherit the blessings. You know, because I always say that when you walk with God, God will take you through a number of tests. Your faith will be tested. But in the test, what happens, you must not lose your focus. The problem with many people, they lose their focus. They lose their focus. Hallelujah. Our focus must not be on the things of this world. That's what happened even to Peter when they were sleeping immediately in the boat. Immediately when they get up, they see a ghost. And suddenly they doubt. So Peter doubts and he thinks that, oh, the Lord calls him. Jesus calls him. He says, Peter, can you come and walk on the water? As long as his eyes was upon Jesus, though he was walking on the water, it appeared to him like as if he was walking on ground. Why? Because his eyes was upon Jesus. His focus was totally upon Jesus. His concentration was totally upon Jesus. But when suddenly what happened, it's that way the devil entered and put a benefit of doubt. Suppose if that is not Jesus, it's a ghost. And immediately fear entered into Peter. And immediately we see in the scripture that he started to sink. Hallelujah. And Jesus says, oh man, I'm little faith. You see, why you doubted in your heart? You see clearly, the Bible clearly says, but as long as his eyes was upon Jesus, though it was a water, he was just like walking, because his focus was totally on Jesus. Hallelujah. That's why the Bible says, let your eyes always be upon him, the author and the finisher of your faith. Let it not be on your situation. Let it not be on your circumstance. Do not look upon man for help, because the Bible says in man there is no help, because their help comes only from God. Hallelujah. And that's what Jesus also promises, that I will send you the counselor, I will send you the helper, which shall be with you, which shall abide in you, and which shall lead you into all truth. And who is the helper that Jesus Christ is speaking in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 16? We know it is the Holy Spirit, my brother and sister, because there is no one else that can direct your life. There is no one else greater than God that can navigate your life, my brother and sister in Christ. And that's very much important for you to inherit the blessings of God, for you to inherit what King Joshua has inherited. He says that we need to fear God, walk in His commandments. Hallelujah. And that's what it is clearly, my brother and sister in Christ. And that's when you walk in the statues of God, when you walk in the thing, what happens clearly, you will see the blessing of God. That's why even if someone curses you also, God will rebuke the curse. That's what we see. If you look into Deuteronomy chapter 23 and verse 5, let us see into Deuteronomy chapter 23. And verse 5, Deuteronomy chapter 23. He said, nevertheless, the Lord your God would not listen to Balaam, but the Lord your God turned the curse into a blessing, because the Lord God loves you. Hallelujah. The Bible says that nevertheless, the Lord your God would not listen to Balaam. Now, Balaam was hired by the Moabite king called Barak for water. To curse the children of Israel. Because you know, in those days, I always say something, that the prophet was greater and more powerful than even the king. Amen. And they had the word of God. That's why when a prophet in the Old Testament, if he said a word, it will come to pass. That was the power of the word which was in the mouth of the prophet, clearly. And here, the Moabite king is hiring who? Balaam the prophet, by telling him that if you come and if you curse the children of Israel, I will honor you with money, I will honor you with gifts. So for the sake of honor of gifts, he wanted to go and curse the children of Israel riding on a donkey. That's the way we see that God's spoke through the dumb donkey and rebuked the prophet because of his foolishness, my brother. Why? Because the Bible says, for the Lord your God turned the curse, and every time he erected 7 altars, and every time when he want to curse, what happened? Instead of cursing, what is happening is blessing. So finally, the king who's there, the Mumbai king, Barak, he gets angry and he says something. He says, for the Lord who you believed and who you trust has forbidden me in blessing you. You see clearly, now he's telling, I want to bless you, I want to give you riches, I want to give you gifts, I want to honor you. But instead of you listening to what I'm saying, instead of you cursing, what are you doing? You're blessing. 7 altars were erected, and on 7 altars, the Bible says clearly that the Spirit of the Lord came upon Balaam. So when the Spirit of the Lord comes upon a person, instead of pronouncing a curse, he started to bless the children of Israel. Because in the sight of God, if you are blessed, you are blessed. Amen. In the sight of God, if you are blessed, you are blessed. Because I told you something, the prophet carried the word of God. Even Abraham was the prophet of God. You see, in Genesis chapter 12 verse 3, see what does it say? In Genesis chapter 12 verse 3. Genesis chapter 12 verse 3. Genesis chapter 12 verse 3.
I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him who curses you. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed.
Hallelujah! What he said? I will bless those who bless you, and I will curse him those who curse you, and in all of your families of the earth shall be blessed. Now God is telling this to Abraham. He said, that means, now only people know that Abraham is the father of nations, but how many people know that Abraham is a prophet? Abraham was also a prophet. That's what I'm trying to come here. That's why Balaam the prophet had the word to bless, to release a blessing and to release a curse. If God did not come then, and if you would have released the curse, the children of Israel would be cursed over there. But here Abraham, God is telling, I will bless those who bless, and I will curse him those curse you, and in all the families of the earth you shall be blessed. Now how do we know that Abraham... How do we know that Abraham is a prophet? Okay, if you look into Genesis chapter 20 verse 7, we know the scenario, what happens clearly over here. Hallelujah. Abimelech takes the wife of Abraham, because Abraham says that she is my sister. Okay, he does not know, he is innocent totally, because what Abraham is telling is believing. He says, who is this beautiful woman? Instead of telling is my wife, he tells, oh, she is my sister. So this king wants to sleep with his sister because she's very beautiful. He didn't say. But that night the Bible clearly says in verse 7 in the book of Genesis chapter 20 verse 7. For therefore restore back the man's wife. For he is a prophet. He will pray for you and you shall live. But if you do not restore her, know that you shall die, you and all who are yours. Now God is telling, speaking to this king in the night. You have not taken his sister, you have taken his wife. But the king is innocent, because what you told is believed. And here down we see clearly that the king gets angry. And he comes to Abraham and he says, why did you lie to me? Why are you telling that she is your sister instead of telling your wife? Abraham says, I thought that the fear of the Lord is not in this land. He said, I, oh, one of my herdsmen that could have slept with your wife and brought this sin upon my whole country. And that's what the Lord says. He says, in the integrity of my heart, I have done for what he says. And the Lord says, that's why I have stopped you, that you may not sin. Restore there, that's why he is saying clearly, restore back the man's wife, for he is a prophet, that he may pray and that you and your household may conceive. Why? Because of Abraham, God stopped the concealment of all the children of his of Abimelech and the whole thing. Why? Because of Abraham's wife.
He closed the womb.
So here God is telling that Abraham is a prophet. Restore back his wife. So that's the same thing. Balaam, Barak, the Moabite king, knew that this prophet Balaam, he had the word. Now Balaam, the prophet of Bilam in Telugu, what we say, was not a false prophet. He was the prophet of the Lord. He was the true prophet.
Amen.
But the king knew that if this person just pronounces a curse, that the children of Israel will be cursed. I have also mentioned before in many times. You see clearly that the power of God. Even when they went and they looked at Elisha the prophet and they said, "Hey, you bold man," they call him. You know, they called the prophet what? Bold man, prophet Elijah, bold man. He says, "You call me bold man? While you're going, there will be two bears. They will come and they will kill you." It happened. They had power in their word. That's why whenever a prophet came into the palace, the king shivered. Because he brought the word of the Lord, my brother and sister in Christ. And that's where we see that nevertheless the Lord did not hearken to the voice of Balaam the prophet, but changed the curse into a blessing. Let's see now what David is saying in Psalm 109 and verse 28. Psalm 109 verse 28. Let them curse, but you bless. Where they arise, let them be ashamed. Let not a servant rejoice. Psalm 109 verse 28. Let them curse, but you bless. But where they arise, let them be ashamed. For let not a servant rejoice. Here David is telling, let them curse, but you will bless clearly. That's what he is clearly telling here. What he is telling? Though they may curse, but Lord, bless. Hallelujah. Why? Because the curse was according to law. See, let's look into Galatians chapter 3 and verse 10. In the book of Galatians chapter 3 and verse 10. Many of us are the works of the law under the curse. For it is written, curse is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. Hallelujah. You see clearly. So Christ himself, what happened in verse 13? So he says, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having became a curse for us. That is written, that curse is everyone hangs. In the New Testament, the curse was broken when Jesus Christ died on the cross of Calvary. But whereas in the Old Testament, the curse was there.
That the blessing of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles.
Yes.
In Christ Jesus, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith.
Yes, it clearly says that. What it says, that the blessing of Abraham may come upon the Gentiles. But in the Old Testament, if you see, only the Jews were the chosen people of God and the Gentiles were cursed. They were not allowed even into the tabernacles of the meeting.
Amen.
To have communion with God, they were not allowed. A Gentile can never come out. You see clearly. That's what even the Samaritan woman, when she looked at Jesus, he was a Jew. He says, what has Samaritan to do with Jews? Why? Because the Samaritans were unbelievers. They were idol worshippers. So when she saw Jews, she recognized them. According to his tradition, according to his culture, the way he must have dressed up, she recognized that he is a Jew. He says, what has Jew to do with this? Samaritans, he says. But Jesus Christ came for everyone.
Amen.
He did not come only for the Jews like in the Old Testament. He came for everyone because salvation and redemption is for everyone. He came in search of that lost soul, that lost sheep which was at the well of Jacob. And clearly we see that what happened, that he gave her the cup of salvation, and not only gave her the cup of salvation, but also given her and filled her with the Holy Spirit, my brother and sister in Christ. Amen. Here. So here Jesus, what he says, he redeemed us from the curse.
Amen.
He redeemed us from the curse by himself becoming a curse when he died on the cross of Calvary, so that the blessings of Abraham get transferred to the Gentiles. Hallelujah. When I say blessing, it is spiritual blessing, physical and financial blessing. And that's where the blessing came upon the Gentiles in the house of Cornelius. When Peter started to preach, they started to speak in tongues and started to praise and worship God. The extra grace was given upon the Gentiles. That's why today the Gentiles are also blessed. Why? It's because of Jesus Christ. He reconciled the Gentiles along with the Jews. And now we have only one covenant. It's the blood of the new covenant. Hallelujah. The blood of the new covenant speaks better promises and better things than that of the old covenant. Because the law in the book of Romans is there. For the law is the knowledge of sin. Hallelujah. And that's why Jesus Christ had to come, and he himself became a curse. That's what in Galatians chapter 3:30 says, that Jesus himself became a curse and redeemed us from the curse, so that the blessing of Abraham
may come upon the Gentiles, my brother and sister in Christ. Hallelujah. And that's when John 3:16 we know, for God so loved the world, it says clearly, world is mentioned. When I say world, everyone is included inside that, includes a Gentile, whether you are a Jew or whatever you are, it says clearly. So Jesus Christ reconciled us once again and made us a part of the new covenant. And that's why today we are New Testament believers.
Amen.
We are not Old Testament believers. We are New Testament believers and we are new covenant. And what is the new covenant? The blood of the new covenant. That's what every time we take. This is the blood of the new covenant, that whenever we eat of his body and drink of his blood, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes, the second coming. That's what the word of God clearly says, my brother and sister. So that is not only the Jews partaker of the blessing of Abraham, but even the Gentiles. That's why today, even the Gentiles, when they walk with God, when they do what God says and he listen to the voice of God and to his commandment, you will also inherit the same blessings that came upon the Jews. But whereas the blessing in the Old Testament was only upon the Jews. You know clearly that. But whereas in the New Testament, we see that they are both Jews. And that's where Paul says, what he says, is he not only the God of the Jews, but he is also the God of the Gentiles. Clearly, Paul clearly makes an open statement to the world, saying that he is not only the God of the Jews, as what you were thinking, but he is also the God of a Gentile. And that problem Peter had, whenever he looked at a Gentile, he remained far. He never associated himself. That's what, when God showed him certain things in the vision, what happened? He said, I must not touch these unclean things or unclean animals. So God is rebuking us. Do not say anything unclean that what God has made it clean. And do not call any man uncommon. He had a problem with the Gentile. You know, that's way, let me tell you. That's way Peter was sent to the Jews, but whereas Paul was sent to the Gentiles. Why? Because Peter had a problem. That's what many people, even after they are born again, filled with the Holy Spirit, they look at their tradition, they look at their custom, they look at their caste feeling, they have all that still in them. They still have that. They have a caste feeling, they have tradition, they have customs. Even they may be born again Christian, even they may be filled with the Holy Spirit, but still they have that feeling. Because why? They are not yet delivered totally. That same problem Peter had. And God knew that. So what God did, God sent him, you go and preach to the Jews, whereas he too chosen Paul. That's where Paul's ministry was more effective than even Peter.
Amen.
And in 2 Peter, Peter is telling the things that Paul, my brother, is writing is very hard for me to understand. That means Paul was moving in such deep revelation that even though Peter was the pillar of the church, could not understand the revelation of Paul. Why? Because Paul was open. He never had a problem within a Jew and a Gentile. But whereas Peter, he always selected his own Jew. That's why in the book of Galatians, when he saw that Barnabas and Paul is coming, he separated himself. But before that, he is acting as a Jew, he is acting like a Gentile. But when he saw Paul and Barnabas, he separated himself and now he is ministering only to the Jews. And immediately, you know what Paul said? He said, you are a hypocrite, he said. He called him in the book of Galatians, he said, you are a hypocrite. He said, you being a Jew, you differentiate between a Jew and a Gentile. How we expect the Gentiles to be like Jews? He was angry. And Peter did nothing. Why? He accepted the rebuke because what he was doing was wrong. And God knew that. That's why I'll tell you something. God knows your heart. That's why God will send you to a particular people, because he knows your heart, because there are certain things which you are there. And God doesn't want you to think in that way. You see clearly, that's what we see in this country. Even though you may be a Christian, you may be a white person, you don't move around with an Asian person, you will not move around even with a black person very freely. Why? Because you still have that in your blood, that you are white. Though you may be a born again Christian, though you may be filled with the Holy Spirit, you still have that problem. I'm a white man. But you will not say that Jesus Christ reconciled a white or a black, whether a blue, whether a yellow, or whatever color you may be, through the blood of Jesus. You know, you still have a problem. You see clearly, we see that. That's why a white man will always go to a white man church. Why? Because he has a problem. Though he may be a spirit-filled person, he may be born again, he must be filled with the Holy Spirit, but still, he still looks at his color. The same problem Peter had. Though God delivered him, filled him with the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost, gave him the keys, and he said, upon this rock I will build my church. But there were certain qualities in Peter in which he was not able to come. What was that? He was always discriminating between a Jew and a Gentile. My brother and sister in Christ, God is open. God does not show favoritism. God does not show partiality. God is not a respecter of person, no matter who you may be. He looks at everyone in the same way. That's what even today, many pastors, they still have problem with women preaching the gospel. Why? They have the problem that I am a man, that only God has called only the men to preach and not the woman. They have a problem. They are not able to come out of that problem because that problem is killing them. You see, but does God look at a woman in a different way? Or does God look at a man in a different way? No! God looks at everyone in the same way, my brother and sister in Christ. That's why he poured out the Holy Spirit even upon the woman on the day of Pentecost. Mary was there. Example, Bible says in Acts chapter 1:14, it says that Mary was among the 120 disciples who received the Holy Spirit. And when the Holy Spirit fell upon them, it fell on equal portion. The Bible says, I give my spirit without measure. Without measure I given it. That means I don't look at some person and give more and some person no. They all received in no same thing. Amen. So today, if you still that means you are still like Peter.
When Peter had come to Antioch,
yeah,
withstood him to his face because he was to be blamed.
Yes.
For before certain men came from James,
he
would eat with the Gentiles.
Yeah.
But when they came, he withdrew and separated himself,
fearing
those who were of the circumcision.
Mm.
And the rest of the Jews also played the hypocrite with him.
Yes.
So that even Barnabas was carried away with his hypocrisy.
Mm.
But when I saw that they were not straightforward about the truth of the gospel, I said to Peter before them all, if you being a Jew live in the manner of Gentiles and not as the Jews, why do you compel Gentiles to live as Jews?
You see, now because Peter, what he's playing, who got carried away? He says Barnabas got carried away of his hypocrisy. So Paul, when he came to Galatia, he said, oh, there's a problem here now. And who was the problem? The problem was Peter. Why? Because in his heart, though he received the Holy Spirit and everything, but they had certain qualities. He always knew, I'm a Jew, and I must not associate with the Gentile. He had the problem, and because of him, what happened? Barnabas, who was known as the son of encouragement, got carried away of what Peter's thing, and immediately Paul came there and he rebuked Peter and he says, that's what he's saying clearly. If you being a Jew, you live in the manner of a Gentile and know of the Jew. So why do you compel the Gentiles to live like Jews? When you yourself, you fellow, yourself is not bloody correct, what are you telling people to think? If the pastor himself is not correct, what do you expect the church to be correct? So here we clearly see that. He had a problem. So what God did? God sent Peter to deal with the Jews because of his problem. And God said, Paul, go. That's where Paul was more effective in ministry. Why? Because if you have to be effective, you must be an open-minded person. You must be a fair-minded person. Then only you can be used for the glory of God. Amen. But when you have these problems, you cannot be effective in ministry. Unless you must be open. Unless you must be broad-minded. Unless you must have a positive mind of taking things. That's when the Holy Spirit will use you in a mighty way. That no one can even restrain in front of you. That's the way we see that Paul was able to write 13 epistles. But whereas Peter wrote only 2. Why? Because there was a problem with Peter. And that's why, because of that problem, he was not able to be used effectively in the ministry. Though he was chosen to be the pillar of the church. Though he was given a revelation, he says, you Peter, upon this rock, I will build my church and I will give you the keys of heaven.
Amen.
Clearly the Bible says. But there was his attitude, there were certain things in his life which he was not able to change. My brother, and that's what happened with many people with us. We filled with the Holy Spirit, we receive Jesus Christ, but ourselves certain things which we are not ready to give up. Hallelujah. And that's the way You cannot be used effectively for the kingdom of God because of there are certain things which are inside you. Unless God deals with you and unless you are ready to give up certain things, that's when you can be used powerfully for the kingdom of God. My brother and sister, today that's what the Lord is speaking to each one of us. Hallelujah. That when we obey the word of God, that we do and seek His face and do exactly what His command says. He says no one can think. He will bless everything. You say hallelujah. He will bless. See in Exodus chapter 23 verse 25. Exodus chapter 23 and verse 25. The Bible says, so you shall serve the Lord your God and He will bless your bread and your water and I will take away sickness away from the midst of you. Says, you shall serve the Lord your God and He will bless your bread and your water. Even your bread and your water need to be blessed. That's what happened when Elijah prophesied to the widow of Zarephath. What did he bless? He didn't ever give her money. He did not give her gold. He says what? The bin of jar. And he said clearly, the bin of flour and the oil jar will not cease. He blessed it. He prophesied. He spoke a word on it. And immediately what happened? The Bible says, till it again rained, that the widow of Zarephath and her children, they ate. Why? Because the Bible says that I will bless your bread and your water. And that's what when the prophet prophesies a blessing, he says clearly. Because what was the main attitude of the woman? She was obedient to what the prophet said. The widow of Zarephath, what she said? She said something. She said, I have a little flour and little oil. We are going to make cakes and today we are going to eat it. And tomorrow I and my children will go. She already is speaking death. And the first verse, what did I show you over there in Deuteronomy? It says, choose between life and death. Choose between a blessing and a curse. So she's choosing death. She's telling to the prophet Elijah, I have little flour, little oil. I'm going to make some cakes. I and my children, we will eat. Tomorrow we do not have food. We are going to die. She's already speaking into life. That's what many people in this planet Earth, they speak. Instead of speaking life into their situation, they start speaking death.
Amen. So she said, yes. The Lord your God lives, I do not have bread. Only a handful of flour in a bin and a little oil in a jar. And see, I am gathering a couple of sticks that I may go in and prepare it for myself and my son that we may eat it and die.
We may eat it and we will die. This is the last meal that we are going to eat. After that, we have decided what?
Die.
To die. But what the prophet said? He said, no, 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 no. First, make me and give me to eat.
And Elijah said to
her,
do not fear. Go and do as you have said. But make me a small cake from it first and bring it to me and afterward make some for yourself and your son.
So clearly we see that when she obeyed that what the prophet Elijah said and she did it.
And thus says the Lord God of Israel, the bin of flour shall not be used up, nor shall be jar of oil run dry, until the day the Lord sends rain on the earth.
Till the Lord sends rain
on the earth.
Hallelujah. In verse 14 it says clearly what? That it will not run dry till the Lord send it rain on the earth. Now what happened? Because before that a prophecy was given to the prophet Elijah and what he said clearly in the prophecy? He says, as the word of the Lord, it will not rain for 3.5 years. And it didn't rain. There was drought. But here, God sent His servant. Why? Because in the book of Exodus 23:25, He says, I will bless your bread and your water.
Amen.
So what was the source of a blessing? Was obedient to the voice of the man of God. She was obedient. She did not argue and say, what are you coming at this moment? I have only this thing and you also want to have a share of what I have. She did not say that. But she obeyed. She obeyed what the man of God said. She obeyed what the prophet said. And immediately what we see there? He spoke a word. A rhema word he released. He said it will not cease till God rains again. That means till it rained. She and her son was never again hungry.
Amen.
They lacked nothing. That is the blessing, my brother and sister in Christ. So let us see into Malachi chapter 3 verse 10.
Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10. Hallelujah. The Bible says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house, and try me in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you such blessing that there will not be room enough to receive it. This is what he says, bring all the tithes and offering and bring it to my storehouse that there may be food in my house, and try me now in this, says the Lord, that I will not open for you the windows of heaven and I will pour out my blessing. That's what, if you have to be blessed, the Bible clearly says that you need to give your tithes and offering to the storehouse of God. Then in verse 11 it says, I will rebuke the devourer for your sake so that he will not destroy the fruit of your ground. You shall eat, nor shall the vine fail to bear fruit for you in the field, says the Lord of hosts. And all the nations will call you blessed, for you will be a delightful land, says the Lord. That's what happened, that you will be, all the nations will call you blessed. Why? Because in 11 he says, I will rebuke the devourer, I will rebuke the devil. So what the devil will do? He will not touch your ground. Why? Why is he telling to the devil? Because in John chapter 10:10 he says, the thief come to kill, to steal and to destroy. Steal what? What to do? Steal your wealth, steal your property, steal your job. You see clearly, to kill you before your time, premature death, to destroy your family, to destroy your marriage, to destroy everything that what God has given to you. Clearly, we see that. That's what happened in the life of Job. In a single day, he lost everything. Who was the thief? The thief is the devil. And here the Lord is telling in verse 11 that I will rebuke the devourer, that he will not touch you. Because even before the devil can touch you, he needs to ask permission from God. Amen. Devil cannot come and touch you and say, oh, I'll touch you now, I like to touch you. He needs to ask permission from God. Because that he lost in the Old Testament, he lost that control. So before the devil can come to you, you must ask God, can I go? Can you give me permission? Then only I can go. If God says, I don't give you permission, he cannot touch you. He even cannot touch your hair. So here the Lord is telling, I will rebuke that fellow even if he wants to come. I will tell him, get out. Because at the command of God, every demon on this planet earth has to bow and obey.
Amen.
Just way we look into the life of Abraham. Who was Abraham? Abraham was also a man who gave tithes. You see in Genesis chapter 14 verse 18 and 20. Let's see what does it say. In Genesis chapter 14. While he was coming back from battle, okay. Then Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought up bread and wine. He was the priest of God Most High, and he blessed him and said, blessed be Abraham of God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth, and blessed be God Most High who has delivered the enemies into your hand. And he gave him tithes of all. He gave him tithes of all. Who gave that? Abraham gave that. And what did Abraham teach his son Isaac? To give. That's why in Genesis chapter 26 verse 12, we see, what does we see in Genesis chapter 26 verse 12? In Genesis chapter 26 verse 12, it says, then Isaac sowed in the land and reaped in the same year a hundredfold, and the Lord blessed him. The man became to prosper and continued prospering until he became very prosperous, for he had possessions of flock, possessions of herd, and a great number of servants. And now the Bible says, so the Philistines, they envied him, they got jealous of him, they envied him. Why? Because this man, everyone is begging for food, there's famine. But this man is being blessed, and the Bible says his position grew, and finally the Philistines, they were nodding, this fellow, what's wrong with him? How is this? He's being blessed so much. Why? Because he learned from his father.
Amen.
What I said before? In chapter 14, that Abraham gave a tenth. That's what I always will encourage people. Give what belongs to God. But people will take it in a different sense. Oh, this pastor is always back of my money. He always wants my tithes. He wants my offering. He wants to eat. He wants to become richer. You lose the blessing. Bible speaks so clearly, it is given. The word of God, he says, what he says? He said that the man became to prosper and continue prospering. Continue. He didn't stop. Continue prospering when he became very, very, very prosperous. Very rich he became.
Amen.
And now they're seeing, the Philistine is seeing this.
because this person is the he is not of them. The Palestinian, you know, they always hated the Jews. So this fellow, what is the thing? One thing Isaac knew, he knew to give to God. Hallelujah. That's what when they brought a coin to Jesus and he says, whose inscription is this? And they said, it belongs to Caesar. He says, give what belongs to Caesar and give what belongs to God. My brother and sister, many people, they rob God of tithes and offering and then they expect God to bless them. The Bible says in Isaiah 59 verse 1, he says, for the hand of the Lord is not short and his ear not dull that he cannot hear you. When you shorten your hand in giving to God, God will shorten his hand in your thing, life. That's why many people suddenly you will see nice jobs they will have, they will lose. Oh my God, I lost my job. Why? Were you unfaithful in giving God? The Bible says, test me. God is telling. What is telling in 3:10 Malachi? Test me. Can we test God? You can't test God. But God in the verse in Malachi 3:10 is telling, you test me in this area. If I will not do, then you ask me. I give in to you now, Lord. I'm testing you now. Now I need my blessing. I'm telling you till today. There is not a person on this planet earth who said that I gave to God and I'm a beggar. Oh, I'm living in poverty. If a person says that I gave to God my tithes and my offering and I'm living in poverty, that fellow is a liar. Because Bible does not say that. Amen. God is challenging. Amen. He's challenging every believer today and he's telling you, test me in this area. If you give and if I don't do what I have promised you to do, then you can come and ask me. God is telling openly. You see clearly. God does not alter his word. In the book of Psalm 89:34, he says, I have spoken to my anointed David and I will not alter the word that I have spoken. He will not alter. He will not manipulate. He will not tell today something, tomorrow he will say something. Man will change his word according to his time, according to the season, but not God. Amen. So he's telling you, test me in this area if I will not do what I have promised in your life. And that's where today many people, they are living in poverty. Why they are living in poverty? Why are they begging? Why they are poor?